Okay, this is Doug Fairbairn. I'm here with Robert Lipp. We are at the Computer History Museum in Mountain View, California. It's February 14th, 2017, and we're here to learn about Bob's contributions in the area of semiconductors and gate arrays and related topics. But before we get to that, welcome, Bob. Nice to have you here. And we'd like to start at the beginning and learn a little bit about where you grew up, the environment, sort of what brought you to the world of technology. So if you could just tell us where and when you were born and just a little bit about your family life, what your father, mother did, and that sort of thing.
Okay, sure. I was born in New York City in Manhattan in 1947. And I was raised there for a few years. My dad was a German immigrant who came over to the U.S. in 1928, having survived the deprivations of World War I in Germany, and came over in the recession, and immigrant with almost no English, and did mostly waitering to survive. He was apprenticed in bricklaying, but depression, there wasn't much of that. My mom was Polish. Her parents were immigrants, and she was raised in Chicago. And they got together in Florida, where they were working at, the Fountain Blue Hotel in Miami Beach.
Wow.
Went to Florida in winter to work, and then New York City in the summertime. They, in New York City, they owned a small, they bought a small apartment house. It was half empty pre-war. They bought it and got a deal on it. And worked all the time, because that's where I got a lot of my ambition from. They were always working, very frugal, from Depression area and coming from families of very little means. And
so when were you born?
47, yeah. And so we lived, I lived early years in this small apartment house in Manhattan, mid-Manhattan. And when I was four, they bought a small resort in upstate New York, upstate meaning about 50, 60 miles north of New York City, mm-hmm. this small summer seasonal resort, 8 cottages, swimming pool, bar. And for a number of years after that, I lived up there in the summertime, and the wintertime I lived in New York City until I was about 11 years old, and then we moved up there full time. That was actually a great place to grow up. I was in the boonies, about 5 miles from the closest town. So. I learned to be very, when my parents working a lot, I learned to be very self-reliant, and always kind of an entrepreneur. And
any brothers or sisters?
I have an older sister, 4 years older, mm-hmm. and she has had a career as a teacher, retired now. Mm-hmm. And we were far enough apart, so we were never very close as kids. 4 years is quite a difference. I was just a bratty younger son, or younger brother. Anyway, yeah, I was always kind of an entrepreneur, and always looking for ways to make money and stuff. I remember when I was 11 years old, some friends from school in the city, we on Halloween we traipsed down to the subway, the shuttle. We started to think of where we can trick or treat, and we thought the shuttle would be a great place between New York City, Times Square, and 42nd Street, and because every just goes. Short period of time, 6 cars empty out, and so we're going through there and hitting up particularly a bunch of young boys, the women, just a penny, and they'd give us a quarter, and we did that for a while until somebody complained to the transit cop and threw us out of there. But I don't know, an hour we were there or something, we made like $11, and then we went off and spent it all on ice cream and such. And then the summer resort, it was mostly seasonal. Most of them were friends from New York City, mostly Italians, and they came up there, and all the kids came and played all summer, and so I always had lots of friends in the summer, and the women sat there and baked when their husbands commuted on weekends, and then when they're on vacation.
Oh, so they'd stay up there for a long period of time.
All summer, all yeah. Summer, so some with school, mid-June to Labor Day, basically. Mm-hmm. And again, my parents were working full-time at the place, at the resort, so I was kind of pretty free to just have fun and do what I want and such.
Own.
But I had certain chores. My dad had me collect the garbage and stuff like that and paid me a little bit for that.
Mm-hmm.
And I was looking for a little bit of something to do. There was since I had New York connections with these kids, they brought fireworks and firecrackers up from the city, from Chinatown. And so I could get these big 80-packet, you know, bricks of firecrackers for, I guess, a dime a piece or something, and or, no, probably not even a dime a piece, cheaper than that. And I'd sell them locally. And so my first...
middleman markup. Huh?
Middleman markup, life of crime. And and anyway, went to parochial schools in Cold Spring. There was just a four-room school. It was a parochial school, two classes per teacher.
Mm-hmm.
And so you always could listen to what the other side's doing. And mm-hmm. Teacher made you do all these assignments and stuff and such. And then went to parochial school in this was in Cold Spring, across the river from West Point on the Hudson. And went to school in Poughkeepsie and took a bus from nearby where we were, Fishkill, to Poughkeepsie. And went there 4 years. Again, being an entrepreneur again, we got there early on the bus, and to have lunches or ice creams, you had to buy these tickets ahead of time. And so I'd buy extra ice cream tickets, and the kids who didn't get there early enough, I'd buy them for a dime and sell them for 15 cents.
Always looking for a buck.
Always looking for a buck. Always an entrepreneur. So just doing stuff. And graduated from there and looking at colleges, and I guess it was a lot easier to get in college at the time because I applied to five different engineering colleges and didn't know which one I wanted to go to and got accepted at all, so damn it.
So is there anything that made you think that engineering was the path you wanted to be on? Was there anybody that steered you that way?
I don't know why. My dad was always very handy in working with stuff and, mm-hmm. and things, and engineering sounded good, and didn't really know much about it at all, mm-hmm. but just kind of electrical engineering sounded interesting.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, what do you know as a kid? You don't know what engineers do or
right.
really anything.
Right.
So I went to finally settle on Clarkson College, now Clarkson University, upstate New York, about 20 miles south of the Canadian border. And in the double D course.
Was it always assumed you were going to college?
Yeah, it was always assumed. I was there. I was mm-hmm. good scholastically. Did won awards and stuff like that. And New York had a good system at the time. I don't know if they still have it, but they had what they call region scholarships and such like that. So depending how well you did in school, you could get a scholarship, which was part based on your own scholarship, how well mm-hmm. you did in school, and part need-based. And so part of my college then was funded by that, part of from my parents, and in part by student loans.
Mm-hmm.
And so I could afford then a private college like Clarkson. And started taking double E courses, and it was interesting because first year they made it really tough. I think about 10% of the students dropped out, and I think that was by plan.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted anybody who wasn't fit for engineering, just
right.
just drive them out with tough courses. And it was actually kind of a shock to me. I started getting C's instead of A's. You know, a couple of them. I got to start working here.
What year did you start in college?
I started in '65.
Okay.
'65. And so, but the second year, though, I realized I was paying tuition for as many courses as I wanted. So I started taking more courses. So I was taking 18 hours originally. I went up to 21 hours.
Wow.
And did that for a couple of years. Stuff in college, we worked on the radio station and other things like that. And by my last year, I realized, I got enough courses, I can graduate early. So I had to take, for my seventh semester, I had to take 24 hours, which I kind of barely squeezed by with one course by the grace of the instructor. I did okay, and I graduated a semester early and saved a lot of money by not having to pay the extra semester.
Yeah.
But then I thought, I'm still here. I had gotten married in college, and my wife still needed time to graduate. So I applied to get into graduate school there, and I got into graduate school in Clarkson, and I got a teaching assistantship, so they were paying my tuition and paying me for teaching assistantship. But after about a month, I realized I just burned myself out. Really didn't know what an engineer did. Okay, I got an engineering degree, but what the heck does an engineer really know? And so I started interviewing for jobs and ended up leaving the college because I was just, like I said, a little kind of burned out with school and not really knowing what I wanted to do. And after looking at various things, I went to work for Schlumberger Corporation, the oil well logging company. And the reason I did that, because it was adventurous. They were going to train me in California, ship me to Alaska to do that, and it was a worldwide thing. And they had some really interesting technologies. They had nuclear technology and electrical, and they did everything. They put, when you drill a well, you don't really know what's down there or even where it is because the wiggle. Mm-hmm. And so after the well is drilled, they lower these tools down, and they do everything like from specific potentials to resistivity to sonics. We had gamma ray cesium to look at scattering, scattering of the gamma rays. We had plutonium. We actually had chunks of plutonium we put down there for low speed neutron sources. And then they had some sort of high thing with with tritium in it, and they with electrical they smashed tritium together to create high energy neutrons. I guess kind of mini nuclear thing. And so they look at the backscatter. So they could tell the concentration. They could tell the porosity, the concentration of the neutrons, which gave you an idea of the amount of water or and oil that was down there, and things like this. So it was very fascinating. Training was very fascinating. I came to California, left my wife behind for a couple months while I went to California to Ventura. And it was interesting because I was supposed to be training on the offshore wells off Ventura, but just before I got there, they had the big blowout with the big giant oil spill. So only critical personnel were allowed on the rigs at first. So I went to exciting places like Taft and Bakersfield.
I've been through Taft.
I did get out of one rig once, and it wasn't worth the boat ride. I get very, very seasick.
There's still nothing in Taft.
Yeah. So I trained there for several months till, April or May through August or something like that. My wife would join me, and then we went to Alaska. And we were stationed in Anchorage, mm-hmm. and there was two locations. They had offshore on the Cook Inlet, and then they had the North Slope. And that was North Slope was just getting going. And so the way it worked is an engineer went with two technicians and did the well logging. But then I realized this is really a glorified technician's job and kind of stressful in some ways because you were on 24/7 on call, and sometimes you go out there because they're so expensive and you just work till you're done. And I remember once when I was in California, still in Ventura, I'd just come back from like a 24-hour well logging thing, and the phone rang. We needed another job, and I look at the clock, 7. I'm looking at the clock. Is it a.m. or p.m.? I had no idea. Anyway, it was a.m., so I had slept like 2 hours. So I was up in Anchorage, and we flew to everything. So we went offshore. We flew by helicopter mm-hmm. offshore, and we flew also to the North Slope. They had these converted 737s that were half cargo and half passengers, and landing on these gravel strips. And planes are specially outfitted with blowers to blow the gravel away so it wouldn't get sucked in the engines and things like that. So anyway, it was interesting in several ways, but like I said, kind of technician-like, and not really what I wanted to do for the rest of my life. But I had adventures. I was up at the North Slope on the shortest day of the year, the 21st, and you know, at high noon, you see just this little glow on the horizon, like the sun's about to rise, and then Northern Lights that are not in the distance, they're right there. Like you can just grab them. It's just amazing. It's just amazing. But I also got frostbitten lungs up there. I was working outside for a while, and it was 60, almost 70 below.
Oh, God.
And we had nice warm clothes and everything. All this fancy down insulated things, but shouldn't breathe through your mouth because I was out there for a couple hours. I'm feeling kind of cold in my chest. I got inside, and just still feeling cold. No, it's warm out here, but it still feels cold. And about a half hour later, man, it hurt. And I realized I had frostbite in my lungs. So they didn't teach us about breathing properly up there. But anyway, so when I was up there, though, the whole thing kind of fell through with the North Slope. That was the first thing. There was a big rush to the North Slope oil, and then the realities, the environmental issues and everything hit their came to the fore. And so everything was put on hold, you know, with the pipeline issues and everything else. And so that whole thing was kind of, for like 5 years, I guess it went, before they finally figured all that out. And so Schlumberger wanted to cut back there, and I was not too happy with my job, and I probably came through to my boss. So I was one of the people let go, which was great, because California had a law that if somebody hires you and brings you to California or to Alaska, I mean, they have to pay your way out. So my boss asked me, where do you want to go, California or New York? I said, you know, give me some tickets to New York. So I took the tickets to New York. I traded them for tickets to Hawaii, shipped a lot of my stuff to California, went to Hawaii for a two-week vacation, flew to California, picked up some stuff, bought a car, and spent the next six weeks touring the nation.
So your wife is back in...
No, she's with me the entire time. Yeah, she's with me the entire time. So we had this six-week slow vacation through the southern states and back into New York. And so here I am back in New York, and okay, what do I do now? And so I was starting to interview and look around.
So what year was this when you got back to New York?
That would have been 70. Because it was about a year I was working on, early 70s, early 70. And there was nothing right around where I was, Cold Spring. It was just, you know, it's not the high-tech mecca or anything. It was just a small town area and stuff like that. But nearby was, in Poughkeepsie, was IBM. And there was a spin-out called Cogar Corporation. And my sister had mentioned, why don't you check these guys out? So, excuse me. I looked them up and got an interview there and got a job. And to this day, I don't quite know why I got that job, because I got a job as a design engineer, designing circuits. And
give us a little background on Cogar. What was it doing? Who founded
it? Yeah,
Cogar
Corporation was founded by George Cogar, who made, I guess, lots of bucks with Mohawk Data Systems, I think
data
it was called.
Yeah.
Which were doing tape drives, tape storage and such. And he founded Cogar Corporation, had two divisions, a systems division and a semiconductor division. And the main thing from his point of view was the systems division, where they're making a tabletop unit with a little tape cartridge in it. And the idea of this was going to be a data entry system, replacing the punch cards, the massive punch cards and all the clumsiness of that, this nice little cassette. But he needed, apparently, to make it work, he needed a little bit more memory, and solid-state memory in particular. And I have no idea. I was, you know, wet behind the ears engineer at the time, so I don't know all the details of it. But they also co-started then this spin-out of IBM in Wappingers Falls, New York, and they were making N-channel memories. And the N-channel memories were, they were really pushing the state-of-the-art at the time. They were, first of all, N-channel. And there was like kind of quasi-dynamic four transistor cell, but with that, this was in 1970. There were 500 angstrom gates, 5 micron, or actually, in that time it was all mils, 0.2 mils, I guess.
Is it metal gate?
Metal gate, mm-hmm. NMOS, and they constricted themselves and because they wanted certain chip size, certain performance, and everything else, and they never really got the process down well to repeatable. They made a few, but this was still the early days of semiconductors. N-channel was hard to make. It was so easy contaminated with, you know, sodium from our hands, and it was tough to get the defect densities down, surface states, and all those, this stuff that people learned slowly weren't really well understood at the time.
So they were trying to make 1K RAM chips, is that?
1K RAM chips, yeah. So, you know, it was really exciting when they got, hey, our gates didn't leak, or yeah, they lithography etched it well. Mm-hmm. So they made some product, but never enough. They could never make it reproducible enough. You know, to give you an idea, this was coincident with Intel starting the same year, virtually, I think. Intel was making PMOS, metal gate, I guess a 3-transistor cell, a different thing, but like 1,000 angstrom gates, 8 or 10 micron
much
gate lenses.
Less aggressive technology.
Much less aggressive. So Intel was making what was doable. These guys were making what they thought was doable, but was not doable at the time. So they struggled a couple of years. They had a very different philosophy, too. They were making systems, so they had an NMOS memory chip, and they had bipolar support chips. So they had sense amps to read the data that was external to the chips, and then drivers. And they sold it as a system as a board. They didn't sell the chips.
So they were making both chips, both the bipolar
and the MOS.
Two completely different processes. And
very different. Yeah, and they had no problem with the bipolar. Bipolar was easy to make at the time, well understood, but the NMOS was not. So, but they could control everything so really well that way by making it on the board and then control the signal integrity and everything else. And so they sold these boards, you know, about 8-inch boards with like a 8x9 array of memory on it. So 1K times, pretty damn small. Mm-hmm. 8K byte, I guess it was.
Right.
And anyway, so I was hired to work on the bipolar chips, the drivers. And at the time, what they were doing, they had IBM used a kind of a master, what they call master slice technology, and they imported and they used the bipolar chips. They put all their bipolar transistors down, and then you put two different patterns. But probably not well thought out because the sense amps needed these balanced transistors and such like that to really make them work small, specific layouts and such. Well, the drivers were these big, immense transistors. And so the two circuits had almost nothing to do with each other, but you had to spend the time figuring out how to lay this one out and lay that one out. In retrospect, it would have been probably much easier to do two chips, get it done quickly, and, mm-hmm. and just make smaller chips. But they kind of liked that idea, and they had mechanized manufacturing. They had really designed everything from early on to be highly automated. They did flip chip technology onto ceramic things, had machinery to do that.
Sort of following the IBM mold in that
regard. Yeah, they just took IBM's everything for their fancy computer systems and tried to duplicate that. But much smaller outfit and stuff made it really, it was a big nut for a startup to chew. Mm-hmm. And so eventually they didn't make it. And it was kind of interesting. Years later, I got a sage piece of advice from one of a VC or somebody. He says, "Never, if you're doing a startup, never make your startup dependent upon the success of another startup." And that's what George Cogar did with his system. He made that dependent upon his semiconductor startup being successful. But anyway, so...
So those were actually two separate companies?
Two separate. The one, yeah, so the one was in Wappingers Falls, was a semiconductor, and up in Ithaca? No, it wasn't Ithaca. Herkimer, New York, way upstate New York, was the, I think, where the Mohawk Data System was, and that's where George Cogar lived, was the system division. So we didn't, at my level, didn't interact too much at all.
So Cogar was the semiconductor...
It was Cogar Corporation with two divisions.
Two divisions.
Semiconductor division and systems division. And George Cogar funded all or most of it. He might have had other funding sources, but I don't know. So as I was saying, that was my first cutting my teeth in semiconductors and chip design.
And what were you doing while you were at Cogar? What were you involved in design? Or?
Yeah, I was designing the bipolar chips. I was involved in the
okay.
bipolar chip design.
Okay.
And where I got my first real crack at chip design. And actually, my first patent, we were trying to figure out how to do some signals, how to make some signals certain precise length. And other engineer looked at one way, says, "Well, okay, I'll take a look at how to shorten it." And I said, "Well, I'll look how to extend it." Or maybe it was vice versa. I don't even know anymore. It's 40 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
More than 40. 47
yeah,
years
ago. God, years.
I hate to think back that far. Surprised I still remember. So anyway, I came up with something, and my boss says, "You got to patent this." "You got to be kidding me." No. So they had a patent attorney, called him in, and ended up getting my first patent for that. So, okay, great. But as I was saying, it was kind of interesting because I didn't like circuit design at school, and then I found out, hey, this is cool because it's creative. It's a different... You do an analysis at school. Somebody says, "Here's a problem, solve it." I don't want to do that. But, oh, okay, come up with creative ways of doing things. It's a whole different ballgame. Very, very interesting in comparison. So I ended up really enjoying circuit design, and I did circuit design for years. And four times now? I was surprised I got a job there because when I first day at work, I asked my boss, what's an MOS transistor? You know, that's how good my education was, because it was double E's at the time. It wasn't the digital and stuff, was just kind of beginning. And a lot of what I learned in school, the way the textbooks were written, this is how a transistor works in comparison to a tube, because professors know tubes, and that's that kind of in textbooks. So even though I had some semiconductor or physics and other things, it was still kind of a hit and a miss. There wasn't really a digital domain like it is today, so you don't know where you're going to be. You might be designing radios or instruments or who knows at that point. It was just a very open field, not concentrated. But actually, my first thing of design, though, I did in my senior year in college. I got an apprenticeship at Kodak. I went to work for Kodak for a summer as an apprentice to an electrical engineer. And they did some interesting things. That was my first taste of electrical engineering, really. Mm-hmm. And what they were doing was designing equipment for manufacturing for their mass production. You know, they had high-speed paper machines and all these things. And they needed lots of controls and ways of for quality and control, et cetera, for that. So I was helping the engineer do a couple of those projects. And that was my first little experience.
So things didn't work out at Cogar.
Yeah, so Cogar in 72 closed the stores. They decided, either ran out of money or decided not to throw good money after bad. I don't know. So Cogar Corporation closed down, so my second little black cloud on my head of my early start of my career. And that was kind of a shock, but we kind of saw it coming. Silicon Valley was just really starting to ramp up at that time, so I started contacting companies in Silicon Valley, and for like a six-week period, every 2 weeks I came over, flew to San Jose, interviewed a couple companies, and went home. And it was fun, because here I was still pretty junior engineer, but a little bit of experience. And each company asked me, what did the last guy, what was your last offer? And they inevitably offered me 10% more. And about half the trips coming over or more, flying back and forth, I was meeting other Cogar people on the planes. It was so great fun.
And so ended up, a lot of Cogar people end up working out here in Silicon Valley?
Virtually all of them, I think, ended up out here. And so I ended up working for National with something like a 50% raise from what I was making, so can't complain.
Is there a particular reason you chose National versus some of the others that you talked to, or was there?
It was hard to make a decision, and National at the time was a pretty exciting place, and they offered me a lot of money. But I was going to do custom chips, and I liked them. Interviewed Intel, they offered me a thing and said, well, you're going to design shift registers, and it really sounded boring. Mm-hmm. And probably was a mistake, but but I didn't go with them. And so I went to work for National, and they're about $100 million company at the time, and they were looking to go on the New York Stock Exchange, be listed. And apparently you have to be profitable like for 5 years in a row, and they were in danger. They were having a little weak period in danger of having a weak quarter and losing money, and would have kept them off the big board. So they had a big cutback, and for about a week, everybody knew it was coming, and really nothing was going on. And it was kind of funny, because I was in the custom group, and there was a guy next to me, a standard, making, I think, memory chips or something, which wasn't doing well. And he was going, if they walk me out the door, I'd like you to take this stuff for me. Yeah, no problem. Well, they walked me out the door, and I think him too. So I was at third cloud, so 5 months at National Semiconductor. Ended up going to work then for a company called Micropower Systems. Got another nice little raise in the process, and that's where I learned CMOS by the name. They made micropower devices, basically CMOS and low power bipolar. And they did stuff like portable instruments and watch chips. And that's where I started designing my first watch chips. I designed two or three different watch chips for them. One of the first chips for Fluke handheld meters that you see everywhere, those type of things. Mm-hmm. One of the first chips, first Fluke portable instrument. So
what year was it you came out to work with National? Was that 72 or 73?
That was 72. That was something like May of 72.
And then a few months later, you went to work for Micropower Systems.
5 months later. Yeah, and it was kind of interesting coming out here. Silicon Valley was still pretty empty, and I wasn't used to the weather, and and some of the smog. So, you know, by August, I'm thinking, God, I wish it would rain just to clear the air and clear the streets a little bit. But I did learn to live with California since then. So, yeah, I went to work for Micropower System, and one of a number of engineers, and they did all custom work.
And Micropower was fairly successful at the time, is that right?
They were doing well at the time, yeah. And they did a lot of sales in here, and they also did sales in Japan with some of their instrumentation and stuff.
So
Japan
was it all custom chips there at Micropower?
It was all custom, yeah, because even the watch chips were custom. We made the watch chip, it was a company for Gruen in Switzerland. And that's when Swiss were trying to figure out what to do with digital watches, and it's big clunky watch, you know, for $200 or something at the time. Well, that's right. That's when I bought my first TI calculator. I remember I bought it, four-function calculator, ordered it in the mail, $150. By the time it got back to me, they sent me a check for $25 because it had gone down. But you think about it, $72, $125. And that's $1,000 or more for for a little four-function calculator, which is about 99 cents now. But it was pretty nice to have.
So I guess we talked earlier, it's important who was running Micropower at the time?
John Hall and was the president. John Marshall was, I guess, their chief technical guy. And so I got a lot of design. We also did programmed our own testing, test equipment and such like that. The testers were still all pretty primitive at that time. And it was interesting because everything was done on Mylar. I don't know if but you remember, it was all discreted Mylar. There was one place in the country, somewhere in, I forgot where, in New York State, where you could buy these big 40 by 36 by 42 inch pieces of Mylar that were precision gridded. And so you designed the layers in different colors, using even the half grids. They had to be pretty precise. And then they put on a light table, you put rubylith on top, and then we had some special people in there. They were all these Japanese ladies. With enough patience to do all this, and you cut the rubylith very carefully on these grids and half grids, and then very carefully peeled, and hopefully you're peeling the right thing. So it was very, very tedious, very, very error prone. So you had to do all these different layers, and then you overlay. Then all these rubyliths you have to overlay and check. Oh, is the gate overlap precise? Is this right? Is spacings, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so there's. Once you calculated at the time, you could make 2.5 errors per square mil of chip area. And I was not the best physical checker. You know, first our layup people checked it, and then everybody. So I've checked this thing for, you know, a day going over all these rubylists and everything else. And I say, okay, and if you can find error, I give you got a beer. So my roommate and another engineer, he was much better at this. So like at 5 minutes, he had won a six pack. So I said, okay, go away. We're going to check this tomorrow. Because it was just terrible, terribly error prone. So, you know, and you have one little error and gate overlap or something, or contact's a little small or something like that, and your yields are down and you don't know why. And then you do all this horrendous debugging processes. So, That was the state of the art at the time.
So you did that for 2.5 years in the early 70s.
Yeah, so I did that for 2.5 years. Mm-hmm. And then always looking for something exciting. I don't know exactly how I came across, but this guy, Joe Sutter, had formed a company called Integrated Circuits International, and with the concept of building a fab plant in Korea.
What was his name?
Joe Sutter.
S-U-D-I-T-H?
S-U-D-D-U-T-H. And he had some prior business engagements in Korea, and had a partner over there so it was a 50-50 joint venture between this Korean businessman and Joe Sutter, who somehow picked up enough. You could start a, you know, it was like $500,000 investment or something that he did. And then he got money from OPIC, the Office of Private Investment Corporation, government branch here, which gave loans to export companies. And so that was the funding, pretty small, relatively small company funding. You know, for $1 million, you could do a fab plant in 70. This was 74. And so I was one of two engineers, and our job was to design some chips and also to go to Korea and teach Korean engineers how to design and how to test. So the company over there, they were building a brick and mortar, in the meantime building up a team, but with new engineers, it was all. Korea was very third world at the time, but had spent a lot of money in education. They were really educating people. So there was a lot of graduates, some smart people. So I went over there a number of times, had some come over here, taught them design, how to test and things like that, and also did designs. So I did a watch chip, one of these LED watch chips where you push the button. It was still one of my favorite ones, these little push button watches. I liked that. But they sold gazillions of those things. They were really successful, hit the market perfect on those. Mm-hmm. So the little metal gate watch chips. And I did a four function LCD display one too, and did that I guess by cheating a little bit. Remember in the early days people worried about copying chips, and even had worked on mask thing. Yeah. I was one of those people that did one of these mask copies. I had taken somebody a competitor's chip, had it photographed precisely to 200x, gave it to a contract designer, who then went over it and with thing, and then I handed it over to a company to make masks out of it. And that guy did a great job. He only made one error, and it turned out that was an option, and the error was in the way that the option that we wanted the chip to work anyway. But so we saved, you know, a couple of months of engineering or something doing it that way. But that's why the mask law probably doesn't have much value now with a billion transistors that you can't see, but in those days a lot of people felt strongly about that for probably good reason.
So you were designing chips for them as a side project?
For ICII, for the fab plant, to feed the fab plant in Korea. Okay. And that was interesting because, like I said, Korea was very third world at the time. Mm-hmm. Went over there and very much still scared of North Korea. If you're American, they loved you back then because you saved them. You know, Americans saved mm-hmm. them from the awful Korean War. But you know, it's just even things like indoor plumbing and stuff like that was very scarce. I stayed over in an engineer's house one night. He invited me over for dinner and stay overnight. And you know, they had an inside pit toilet. They were high middle class.
Wow.
So and a lot of homeless people living in little shacks along the river and stuff like that. And there was only one good hotel, the Chosun Hotel, which was okay. But I always got sick over there. Always got sick. There was nothing I could do. I was at the point, the only thing I'd do is I'd drink DI water from the fab plant and still get something. And this plant was out in a little place called Buchen, about a half hour drive, 20, 30 minutes drive out of Seoul itself towards the coast, towards Buchen. And they had a couple-acre plot, and they built this small fab plant on half of it. And eating a cafeteria, and even cafeteria food that the locals couldn't abide by. And if you've ever eaten Korean food back in those days, I had philosophy, there was two countries that didn't understand good food, Korea and England. But it was so hot, even they couldn't eat it. And they, you know, some things like these little fishies just covered in like sriracha sauce, and they had these little pointy stainless steel things. And, you could almost starve to death because you have to pick little tiny bits of fish between the bones to eat. And you had to be good with hot foods, which I wasn't too much at the time. And it was interesting because they had this dichotomy. They were trying to promote their internal industries, and so they had a lot of laws in place, import laws, right? So one of the things is they couldn't import a lawnmower. And there was apparently a lawnmower. And
oh.
There was no lawnmowers. So when the lawn needed to be cut, there was like 20 women on their hands squatting down, cutting the lawn with scissors going in a row all the way across like this acre. I mean, it's giving jobs to people, right?
Yeah,
and they're blatantly discriminating towards men because men were supporting the family. So, you know, women had jobs, but they needed to have families have the main income. So it was a lot of things they did like that. And one of the things we had importing an implanter. So as they expanded the plant, implant machine. and really needed this implant machine, expensive, like $750,000 machine, and they could not get it through customs. It took them like 9 months to get through customs, even though it's a critical piece of equipment, they're promoting high-tech business, right. They still had this thing. And it was kind of interesting, people talk about bribery and all that. They had the company's books, they had 2% of the money, they didn't have to say where it went. This was the law. And it was very rigid. You know, if somebody puts a chop on your import thing and, you know, maybe you give him 100 won for doing that, you know, if you give him 1,000, it's bribe, but if 100, it's a tip. And in the hotel, we always had this little newspaper, the American English newspaper they threw under. And one of the articles emphasized that. They had an article where Supreme Court had overturned a bribery charge for a woman accused of bribery, or convicted of bribery, and says, and the Supreme Court said, no, it is okay to tip a government employee. And so you just have to know what size tip.
Right.
Anyway, so it was quite an adventure. So I went over there quite a number of times. So
what became of that?
Eventually, Joe Sauter's partner didn't have enough money to continue it. So he sold his half of the venture out to Samsung, Electronics. And then about a year later, Joe Sauter sold his portion out. And what's now Samsung, this is now what Samsung Semiconductor started from, so in Buchen. And so that's kind of interesting. So I'm one of the founders of Samsung Semiconductor.
Wow. Never knew that one.
No, a lot of little weird things in the world, isn't there?
Yeah, that's a good story.
Yeah. So simultaneously while I was doing this, I was approached by a couple of ex-Cogar people, and they were Frank DeVerse and Charlie Allen, and they had an idea for a business based upon master slices, because they're familiar with the master slices at Cogar and IBM. And they thought the world needed a CMOS master slice.
So a gate array.
Yeah, which is now a gate array. Mm-hmm. And so they approached me, and they knew me and I had experience in CMOS. And so I worked with them, and I designed a family of gate arrays, which they started going peddling. I forget the name of the company. They had made iron oxide masks, hard masks, for lower defects. All the masks up there, or most of the masks up to them were photographic, and they emulsion, and they wore out very quickly, were prone to defects. So people were going to hard masks. Iron oxide was one of the technologies. They had chrome masks also, but they were also, that was kind of a small business. They wanted to expand some more. And so I worked out a deal with them where I did it for free. But if it was successful, I was to get 15% of the of a company that they were going to form based upon that. And so this was 74, 75 when I did this for them. And then they took it and ran with it. And that first Gator I did for them pioneered some early concepts, which seemed kind of trivial in retrospect. But we're different. There were some gate arrays or master slices done by Ferranti, I think, was probably the biggest at the time, though they're not very big. And they had bipolar, and Fairchild did something which I'm not too familiar with, or mosaic or micro mosaic, whatever it was called. But I think that it ended. So Ferranti was really the only one with, I think they called it a ULA, something array.
Universal logic array.
Yeah, universal logic array, thank you. And but it was bipolar, very small, very limited, and random. So you had to hand draw everything. So I came up with some concepts to make this more readily designable. I used the the transistors were arranged in like two pairs of twos and threes, the CMOS, so they could be easily wired in different combinations, and also put on grids, so they were very regular. And the way we ended up designing these things at the time, this was, you know, late 70s, was automation was abysmal. Computers were really too slow to do much of anything. I did digitize the first array on a CAD system, and the main reason for using CAD systems at the time was not for automation or speed. It was actually slower, but you could check things. Mm-hmm. So you could run DRC design rule checks and things like that. So that was...
Got them into a digital form where you could check it.
You could manipulate them. And so it was the very first inklings of what you, of of what you could do. So we went through the painful process of digitizing to do that. And you could also erase stuff easy. Mm-hmm. But as far as the making a master slicer, we got a design from a customer and told him, you know, this is how you can design it. And it was a family from 50 gates to 600 gates. And 600 gates was a couple hundred mils, probably barely manufacturable. Mm-hmm. And so 200 gates was kind of the sweet spot. And it was designed mostly for what we call garbage collection. So most of the systems at the time were built on small PC boards, and you see transistors and NAND gates and NOR gates, all this LSI, SSI, MSI stuff. And the idea was to get rid of a lot of that and just put it on one chip. You can compress your system and potentially make it cheaper. Mm-hmm. And the way we designed it, we took the hand-drawn schematics and made photographs, I think it was 200x of the chip. And we made decals for common functions. If you want a NAND, an OR gate, particularly flip-flops. Mm-hmm. And you just made a decal, and you pasted it down. And then, so all the gates and everything were decals. And then the wires themselves, we used PC tape. With the PC boards had gone from rubolith to a fine tape. Right. And you just put that out, cut it, and there are your lines in place. And so it was this hybrid thing. And then make mass the traditional way at the time was you hang this on a wall and there's this big giant camera on the other wall that took a precision photograph of it and made the mask from there. So that was the state of the art in 76, 77, 78. Mm-hmm. Anyway, by the time 77 rolled around.
This is a double level metal.
This is still a single level metal.
Single level metal.
Yeah, so the interconnects were one direction metal. The other direction, diffusions, and through channels, and power was distributed through diffusion with some metal straps to reduce it. So it was pretty slow. You can only do slow stuff with it, but it was a lot of applications just for that. So by the time 77 rolled around, ICI Vision here had closed and become Samsung Semiconductor overseas. So I went looking for new things. And went back to looking what they call this, it wasn't MasterMOS, it was something else. But anyway, I went back to these guys, and they had started to make a good business out of this. And they cut one of these bubbles. Everybody was looking, semiconductors early days, what's the next big thing? And the next big thing happened then, which was CB radios. And they had a fairly good business going on. Some circuits for CB radios. And so at that point, let's form a company, let's get going. And they said no. They didn't want to do that. They're just going to keep the company. And so I was, here's $1,000 for your contributions. And I was a wee bit upset about that. So I ended up taking them to court. And believe it or not, a three-week trial, just for something as simple as that.
Is it jury trial?
Jury trial, yeah. And so it took a lot of time, and they made all these things. Oh, anybody could have done that. You had conflicts of interest with your job, blah, 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 blah. Just throwing out nonsense. But anyway, finally won the lawsuit, won a judgment of $120,000 from them. But they didn't really have the wherewithal to pay me the judgment, so they were hemming and hawing and weren't paying me. So I had my lawyer, he put a sheriff in their offices who opened the mail and collected all their checks coming in. Which was kind of fun. But so finally they were under enough pressure, and so we arranged a settlement. So we settled for half of it, $60,000. But of course my lawyer bills were half of that, 30, so I ended up with pocket money of $30,000, which mm-hmm. This was 1978, which was a fair chunk of change, maybe, five, six times what it's worth today. But I got to know the advantage of this whole thing through discovery. I got to know the intricacy of this business and said, geez, this is a pretty good business. And I had been consulting for a while there after ICII with a company called Pico Design. Bernie Aronson had a small company, a design company, doing custom designs. And I was discussing with them that I want to form this company. So we decided we'd form this company and put some money in it. But we know each other through working together, but not enough really that, okay, do we know each other to trust each other to start a business? And we weren't sure of that, but we both had a mutual acquaintance, Brian Tai, who we both knew and trusted. And so he became the third investor, and it was like $20,000 from me, $20,000 for Pico Design, and $10,000 for Brian Tai.
So you didn't actually work for Pico Design. You went and started a separate company.
I did a contract chip or two for them.
Okay.
So I did a little contracting. And then I started California, what was California Devices.
Mm-hmm.
And we always kind of joked upon that with, California. It doesn't make it in semiconductors, whereas I'm sure there's some other business or something like a name like that would be useful for. So my whole business plan was a piece of paper, 11 by 17 spreadsheet for 2 years.
All done by hand, right?
By hand. Here it is. And surprisingly, like 12 months later, I predicted a $10,000 deficit and cash flow negative and hit it right on, loaded the company some money there, and then went up after that. So it was surprisingly accurate for really off the cuff. And since it was at the beginning only me, designing this thing, Bernie Aronson had customers and that were potentially interested, so I got some sales through that and got some business. And he was in an office complex, and I took the office next door to his and had a back door. So customers come in my door with California Devices, tour them around his offices as well as mine, and never realized how small I was.
Not the first company that did that.
Yeah. So I grew and moved to another office down the way, and after a year, I had to, the things developed and got a little production going.
Mm-hmm.
First year, just 50,000 sales. Half of it was just getting going, and hired a couple layout designers. And
so you were doing all the circuit design.
I was still doing all the circuit designing and selling everything. Yeah, and so.
And was the layout done in the way you described before?
It was all pretty much done the same way. Yeah, I think because at some point we're starting to move towards. More CAD, but I don't remember if that was then or not. Probably not. The first one was probably done the same way.
That is with the blowing
tape,
it up and...
Blowing it up in the tape and such, yeah.
Taping it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it was like $50,000 in sale the first year, and then I think close to $250,000 the second year, and then tripled out like $750,000 the third year.
And what was the complexity of the gate arrays at the time?
There were, again, 50 to 600 gate metal gate to start off with. And because I was really pushing the limits, we were doing about 5 micron technology. And CMOS was always the stepchild of the fab world. People were it's really only market to start off with was low power, and so they didn't really care about high density or speed or anything else. But it was always, I always thought, I've got to get this on a high speed process and then you could do something. In fact, it was kind of interesting in that time frame, maybe earlier. I remember reading an article by some Intel guru who says, no, we just use N-channel. We'll never use CMOS because it's too slow, it's too complex, too many masks. And I'm thinking, you just move it to a modern process and it'll kick ass.
Right.
Eventually
exactly.
they saw the wisdom of that,
power became the problem.
Power became the problem, and CMOS is higher speed than MOS.
Yeah.
You didn't have the complex dynamic circuitry with the precharge and the higher voltages that you need to make that work and such like that. So anyway, after 3 years.
So what kind of designs were you doing? What were a couple of examples of customer applications?
God, I don't remember too much. I remember one like was a tachometer for an airplane.
Mm-hmm.
Like a little AD, it did the logic for the ADD. Something for, I think one of them was like for a modem. Maybe it was Regalvedic or somebody did a modem chip.
Mm-hmm.
Things like that, which were just stuff that people
needed. Just random stuff they needed.
Yeah, random stuff they needed and made it happen. It was kind of interesting when you think at the time, other than gate arrays, there was standard cell coming along too, but it was all, the standard products were all small scale integration. Then they went to MSI, SSI is 10 gates, MSI is 100 gates, LSI is 1,000 gates. But the standard products were going through a problem. Nobody knew. There were no standards. So what are we going to do because there were no things.
As it became more complex, they didn't know what to make.
What to make as a standard product.
Right.
And it wasn't until almost years later we started getting Ethernet systems and other things like that. All of a sudden they had this rash of large, what they called ULSI at the time, standard products came out. But there was kind of a crisis of theirs. What do you do now when the semiconductor technology outruns the design capability of all the custom?
Yeah, that's why Gordon Moore said that Intel pursued memory, because that was the only large-scale thing they could build that they could sell a lot of. Otherwise, they didn't know what to make for large-scale chips in the logic area.
Yeah, and custom was a pain, you know, because the automation was still primitive until companies like yours, VLSI Logic, came along and started adding both the simulation and the design tools to really make it happen without. Mm-hmm. It became, the designing became scalable, or it was not really scalable up until then. So at that point, I was into the California devices for 3 years, and we were growing organically ourselves and by being tight with the buck, which I learned from my parents, and getting enough money, we got some licensing money to license like Metro Harrison in France, and doing a deal with Olympus Optical, got some money for funding it. But it's when you think about growing 300-400% a year, which I was doing, you have to put the infrastructure in today for tomorrow's sale. So if I'm a $500,000 company, and in 2 years I'm going to be a $5 million company, I've got to have the infrastructure now to support that $5 million. And selling, particularly, was the thing I never could get my, you know, I always had trouble keeping that under 20% of a revenue, and that was not enough to go out there and then sell. And then we offered our thing was a lot of design support. So we had engineers then to help the customers design it, and then the hand layouts and such. So it was a very hands-on, labor-intense, engineering-intense thing, and that fit very well for the smaller companies. But you take responsibility, something goes wrong, it's your fault. And so, and kind of one of the things interesting that I found out was three things can happen when you make a chip like this. One is you can screw up, things go wrong, you'll never see that customer again, right? Two, it can go smoothly as hell, everything's beautiful. Customer says, this is easy, this isn't a problem, next time I'll find the cheapest vendor. Or three, something goes wrong and you can make heroic rescue. The customer loves you because you made it for half. Oh my God, this is hard, but these guys took care of me. Then you have a customer for life. But I never could figure out how to institutionalize that.
Now, was there competition at the time?
So in 81, there wasn't really much competition till LSI came along, 81. Now, LSI had Wolf Corrigan and Bill Lemire, Rob Walker had spun out looking to start a gate array company. And I guess that was, they probably had gotten the thing from their time at Fairchild with the stuff they had. And they were going to make ECL gate arrays, high speed, high performance. And they had gone out and looked at customers for 6 months or something and realized there wasn't a market in that. And they wanted to get started. So they approached me for a license deal on our metal gate CMOS. And so I ended up licensing them the metal gate CMOS, and for royalties plus cross-license arrangements with their design systems. But it was limited. I needed to make their design systems work. I needed to put in infrastructure with engineers and computers and so forth, which I did not have the capital to do. So I was never really able to implement that. But LSI had almost a completely different philosophy than we were doing. They came in as they got something like $6 million funding, which was huge at the time. And they came in like, okay, we're a big company, glitz on their big building and everything else. And when it sold themselves as a big company, even though they weren't.
Right.
And didn't have a flat panel, they did put in metallization. And in fact, at the beginning, they didn't even have metallization. They did, I think they got a good deal with Toshiba. They found a really good vendor in Toshiba with two-layer metal, which really, really gave them a boost. And so they hit, you know, the decks and other things. So they got the big customers with big orders at the time, and it worked very well for them with this big company, I think. And it was kind of interesting because I remember one company coming through and talking to the engineers, and they had just been LSI Logic, and they did not realize LSI Logic was a fabless company. They thought it had a full fab. So LSI did a great job of doing that. And so LSI became the very successful with the bigger orders, bigger companies. Well, we were still
right.
at the kind of the handheld, smaller craft shop mm-hmm. type of thing, which was okay until the early 80s, around that time, and afterwards, the semiconductor business started hitting with rolling recessions. Like every year or two, there was recessions, and the semiconductor business was just on this absolute roller coaster in the early 80s. And LSI Logic was still selling stuff, but you know, early on, and I was getting royalty checks, which were indicating they were selling four times the amount I was selling of my own product, which was good news, bad news. I got this nice royalty check, but it's like, where are they selling all this stuff, right?
Mm-hmm,
And you know, it was these big companies, and they sold design time. They put in a big design system, and so they sold timeshare and a godly rate. So they made a lot of money on timeshare revenue, which really funded them early on. So they kind of avoided this silicon recession by having these companies, their design engineers, they took responsibility and they just shoveled money at LSI Logic to use their tools. In the meantime, in like it was 1982, IBM announced their, I think it was 3084 computer, and that was the one that had their fancy cooling, the thermal control module, a big ceramic thing with like 100 chips in it.
Mm-hmm.
And they were talking about this being all done with gate arrays. Oh, good, we're getting publicity, you know, mm-hmm. so gate arrays are good. So all of a sudden in every, you know, rag, the local rags of the electronics, gate arrays, gate arrays, gate arrays. And there's 20 Silicon Valley companies struggling to make a living out there, and they're thinking, what's something we can enter? Gate arrays. And it's pretty easy to there's not a lot of barriers to enter to get started with gate arrays. And most of these companies, you know, they didn't have design systems or anything else, and they said, how do you get market share in semiconductors? Lower the price. So every company came in and said, oh, what's the market? Oh, we can cut that by 10%. So all of a sudden, these new entrances were selling chips at a loss, and I'm trying to make a company
right.
go at survive against that. So it got very hard for a while. And so that was happening with this compression of things. Also, had to get into silicon gate, like 81, wanted to get 81, 82, get into silicon gate CMOS. And so we struck a deal with AMI to be our foundry for silicon gate. And we had made some prototypes, had sold some designs, and AMI lost the process, completely lost the process down here in Santa Clara and in Pocatello. And they were struggling. They lost it, I think, for like 9 months. So I'm really hanging out to dry. I had all these customer orders I couldn't fill. Silicon-gate CMOS was still very rare. Now, we had gotten funding. We got a second round of funding a year later after our first round, because with all the issues and building up, buying computers, having struggles with a lack of income, of profitable income. So went through, got another round of funding, which I barely managed to keep at the same price as the first round, because my first round of investors, they invested in this company that's growing at 300% a year, 20% pre-tax profits, looked well run very nicely, and then the shit hit the fan. And so a year later, all of a sudden, I'm underwater, needing cash, hemorrhaging, and they felt misled.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't, philosophies then are very different. Now it's just throw money at thing and hope you've got a unicorn, and if you don't, you wipe right on you. They invested in a company they expected to continue to grow like it is. And as I said, so I had both the cost of growth, the market issues, et cetera, all happening at once. So I managed to get another $750,000 at essentially the same rate, which was like, whew, and it kept going. And we put in a back-end metallization plant in a small building in San Jose, and I had a couple of good process engineers, really good process engineers. And one of them worked with a small company called Universal Semiconductor, and within several months, he managed to install a silicon gate process in their fab plant. And so we got up and running again. But it was touch and go for a while for that until we got that going.
Wow. Tough times.
It was
customers
it was,
beating down your door and
it was tough. So it was just a lot of things to happen at once. So we survived that. We still grew. You know, I grew like from 800,000 in the second year, 250, 2.5 million third year, and I think like over 5 million. So we're still growing at a good rate, managed to recover and grow, but profitability was really, really tough. It was always right around zero, rather than the pre-tax of 20% that my investors were used to. So it was interesting too, with this metal gate and everything, there was not a fab industry around. I was one of the few companies that was buying anything like fabless. And there was a lot of small companies starting up, making, like I said, easy to start a company with semiconductors. So we ended up sampling, a lot of them were schlock outfits. So we ended up sampling over several years, like something like 30 different vendors.
To do the foundry for you.
Yeah, we taught how to be foundries. Right. And it was very interesting because one of them, like we went to Japan with Sony, everybody had a fab plant. And we sent some masks to Sony, and they didn't understand whether we wanted P-well or N-well. So instead of coming back and asking us, the Japanese, something about the Japanese mentality, they sent us a run of, here we made it in NMOS or N-well, and here we made a P-well version of it. And very fine product, but you know, it's just funny things like that. You could have asked us.
So what complexity did you get to? And did you start to incorporate your own design tools?
Yeah, so we slowly started incorporating design tools. We got, like I said, we got a prime computer. It was like a VAX computer, but you know, a fraction of the cost, like something like $250,000. We bought some CAD design tools, digitizing tools. Very slowly started implementing automation, but we're still way far behind. You know, automatic placement route. We had all the DRCs. I think we started getting. Early on, automatic placement was very, very difficult in a single layer. It was just too difficult to automate. So we kept that by hand. But we started getting ERCs and DRCs in place to check what we made, which, you know, that's if you can check, you're so far ahead.
Get to double level metal or?
Yeah, so one of the ideas when we put our metal plant, our back end metal in, was to develop metal, a double metal. And I hired an engineer, a process engineer, who had previous double metal experience at Intel and put in a double metal in. So by 84, 85, we probably had the double metal, I forgot. So I ran the company up till 83 for 5 years. And going out and raised another 6 million, I think it was. We actually went through some bankers and such and flew around the world, got a chance to go on my first one and only ride on SST. Put us up, you know, the bankers, you know. They built Billy back out of what they fund, and they put me up at the Ritz in Paris, you know, so it was a great adventure for me. But we were supposed to raise 10, we only managed to raise 6 at the time. And I had hired a president and remained a CEO for a little while, and then I resigned as CEO, became chairman and CTO. And then I developed what was called our DLM process, our first DLM, double layer metal, obviously. With what we call channelless, and by manipulating the lower levels of silicon, the metallization, extra layers of metallization became much, much easier and much denser. We got like a 40% increase in density on the chips.
It was sea of gates?
Sea of gates type but very specialized sea of gates. So they wove in certain patterns so you could grab the metal and in very common things like flip-flops and complex gates, you could just metal just went down smooth, and you could interleave interconnect metal very painlessly throughout. And so I led that design, but it got kind of confusing being president of a company for 5 years, and then kind of becoming CTO and going down engineering and work. They never really knew how to treat me. I'd make an offhand suggestion of did you try this or that. And all of a sudden, it became an order rather than a collaboration.
Yeah.
And so it got awkward, and I finally just left in 85.
Who did you bring in as president originally?
His name escapes me at the time. He only lasted about a year or two, and then after I left, another president was brought in by the VCs, Doug Ritchie. who kind of ran, he raised a lot more money, bought a fab plant in, old fab plant in Colorado, and basically ran a company and did ground. But,
so when did you leave?
85. Mm-hmm. The company went for a few more years after that. I guess it, yeah, I left it, I think at, when I left, it was like 12 million and never got any higher than that. Mm-hmm. I started throwing money at technology and stuff, but never really got the sales and stuff going.
And so did you do something after that, or what was your, been your past since then?
So that would be, put me at 85. So I consulted a little again. I did design consulting and test consulting and some other things like that. And I always fell back. I did a fair amount of consulting, design consulting, test consulting over the years. And then I was approached about 90. Gentleman by the name of Shark Jawala. He was out of IBM, wanted to start a company in testing. Mm-hmm. And I guess a mutual friend had put us together. And his idea was that these custom chips were very, very hard to test. It was one of the really outstanding problems nobody really solved. In an instruction environment like IBM and such, they use scan and other techniques.
Right.
But it was very difficult to implement scan and teach customers scan and also have the design styles of synchronous and
right.
such like that.
Yeah.
And so they came up with this idea of just embedding an array of test points throughout the entire array. Mm-hmm. And so we put an XY matrix in the array, and then you could access it, and you could even inject signals. Mm-hmm. And so I was in charge of developing the arrays, and I think we did it with like a 10 or 15% overhead. It was really small overhead.
Mm-hmm.
And then that was, you could I had another a team for software, a few people to develop software so you could interact. But mostly random patterns worked very, very well at that point because you had 100% visibility.
Mm-hmm.
So even though you didn't have, you know, with testing, it's two things. One is a stimulus and the other is to see the stimulus, to see the reaction.
See,
but if you got 100% visibility of every node, stimulus actually is easy. You can, in fact, random patterns and maybe a simple test pattern by the customer would stimulate every node.
Mm-hmm.
And so we collected the signatures with an XY matrix, like a memory matrix. And then we use a technique, I'm using the word signature because I think HP had a
signature analyzer.
Yeah, they did something similar or started that concept. And you put it into a linear shift register, and actually it was a multiple input linear shift register, and then you clock it. It had complex feedback, and you end up with this pattern. And if the pattern was valid when you were all done, it was extremely high probability because it was like a 50-stage shift register, and the probability of a signature not being duplicated was almost nothing.
Yeah.
And in fact, it was kind of interesting because I did a patent on that. It's called a MISR, multiple input shift register.
It's called what?
Multiple input shift register, okay. MISR, rather than LSI. And it was the only patent. I've got 20 patents now on various things. One of the advantage of being always being leading edge with stuff is mm-hmm. new technology. Nobody's done it. You can collect patents. And this patent, I sent it in. 9 months later, I got the patent. There wasn't a comeback from the, there wasn't a question. There was nothing from the patent office. Here's the patent. 9 months later, it's like, what? Because normally it's like they throw shit at you just so they...
Right, they throw it out and make you come back.
Yeah, but there was apparently nothing, anything like it that they could find. So, okay. So I was there for a few years and then...
What was the name of that company?
Cross-check technology.
Oh yeah, I remember cross-check
technology. Yeah, and we were licensed LSI Logic because I had mm-hmm. connections there with the people I knew there, and Fujitsu, and I think Sony. We had at least three licensees before when I left,
mm-hmm.
and then it was the company was acquired by another small company called Duet Technology,
mm-hmm.
who did they did simulations and other software stuff, so it kind of mm-hmm. fit in with their thing. And I'm not sure whatever happened, how they was promoted after that.
Yeah, I remember cross-check. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, so we liked every time we got on a plane, you know, they said seat belts, cross check, and hey, name in our company. So left there after that. And that was minimal funding, too. We had like $1 million in funding in the company, mm-hmm. and very little. I did some more consulting, and I did a little company in Los Gatos, International Business Systems. They did lots of rights reports and stuff like that. And I wrote things about testing and other things for him, and a little bit of some gate arrays. And actually, I did that prior to, that's what I did prior to. Now go back, that's what I'm trying to figure. The gap after California Devices, I did at least two gate array projects for customers turnkey. One was for Brothers, the one that makes printers and stuff. For some reason, they wanted a gate array family.
Right.
And Vertex, which was a Toshiba subsidiary in Silicon Valley. Mm-hmm. So I did that. Did complete documentation, everything. So it was a big job. So that was kind of filled most of my consulting for those couple of years doing those projects.
Doing gate array design.
Yeah, these turnkey projects for these guys. Because it wasn't just the gate array. It was the libraries, the design manuals, all that stuff. So both of them ended up being fairly big projects.
Right.
And so that puts me to, 93 or something like that when I left there. And so I did consulting for a while. And when I was working for this company, IBS, doing some work for them, there was another person there, Phil Hughes, was also doing some consulting there. And the guy, the owner, Handel Jones, put us together because Phil had some ideas about networking. And some very interesting ideas, but the networking needed a chip to be designed to mm-hmm. make it happen. So we hooked up together, and we got some venture funding, and started what became, changed names a couple times, became Brightlink Corporation.
Brightlink?
Brightlink. Uh-huh. And we started out with $2.5 million venture funding, and this was all a little bit more conventional nowadays because we're just starting, we have to develop a chip. Mm-hmm. And what we started out, I guess about a year developing technology and stuff, thinking about putting this networking technology. It was big. The idea was it was little boxes, was how do you make big networks? And it was kind of based upon some stochastic processes and things. It was very, very different. And instead of like to use fat trees and other things like that, all these other fixed networks, and we looked at various applications. Originally, we thought, well, we'll make a big networks, a big Ethernet switch, like a 1,000-port Ethernet switch. And we did a lot of work, and we got some funding, and we looked around some more. I'm not sure how the thing came up because neither one of us are telecom guys, but we ended up developing a SONET switch, that's a synchronous optical networking, which is the big telecom thing. And the SONET. So all the early opticals were SONET-based, and a lot of people didn't understand SONET well because they think, oh, Ethernet in this network. But it was like a layer. It's a virtualized physical layer is what SONET was that provided management and fault tolerance for the fiber. So, and it was excuse me. So you take these high, like at the time, maybe 155 megabits and 2.5 gigabits when you start to get the OC48s, and that they would chop that up into smaller segments and deliver all the way down to your mm-hmm. your phone line or maybe a T1 or a T3, various things. A T3 would have been 48 megabits, and so you get 1,000 of those in a OC48 and so forth. And we built continued to get more funding. We developed a chip. We built a 1,000-port SONET switch, OC48 switch. So huge for the marketplace. But it was segmentable, and it was, like I said, based upon very different principles, and very, very successfully. But it was all the networking was stochastic. So engineers hired really bothered them, both the hardware and software. You know, I can't get my hands around this because, you know, it's like a big pachinko machine. You know, it'll come out, but, you know. So, you know, in fact, I had this brilliant PhD working for me, a young guy. And it was like every other day, well, why don't we try this battery? Why don't we try this other network? Why don't we try this? And, you know, no, we're going to build this thing. And, you know, it really bugged him because and it was not easily, you know, engineers like
right.
predictable
Certainty
stuff.
And specificity.
And yeah, so as soon as you get to some random processes,
So what was the random aspect? I mean, what was being randomized? Was
packets. So what the switch was, so SONET is a, all telecom is circuit-based.
Mm-hmm.
Even though it's packetized and brought up, it's still a circuit-based. It's virtual circuits.
Mm-hmm.
But we made a truly packet-based switch. So we emulated a circuit-based switch in real time.
Okay.
With a packet system, with no loss of packets. In fact, we finally figured out one of the advantages of statistical methods is you can actually use statistics to calculate the things.
Right.
And we said once in like 10 to the 30th years, this would have a lost packet.
Mm-hmm.
Or if it was broken, we calculated like 15% of the links were broken, it would drop down to 10 to the 15th years of a lost packet.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we were so far over the top in reliability on this thing. And it was very, you only put, you didn't have to calculate paths, so there was no setup time. Like a competitor had one, it took like 3 hours to set their machine up. Ours, it was like 3 minutes, or not even 3 minutes, 30 seconds or so. Just go.
Right.
And the BOM was low. The bill of materials was cheaper than competition. It was a great success. In fact, it was one of the interesting things. One of the designers had messed up with the PC boards and miswired one of the wires. It wasn't found for a long time because the machine still worked with this wire, totally miswired. It never caused an error, and somebody was found by accident. The wire's wrong.
So this must have been worthy of a few patents along the way.
Yeah, so there was another number of patents in there, and mm-hmm. And some good patents. I missed a whole thing in between. I'll go back.
Okay.
But and
That's fine.
So yeah, so. Where was I now? So
so you said this was 93.
So no, this was actually by 98. So that's why I skipped a whole job in the middle. So I've got to go back to that.
Okay.
So this anyway, we kept raising money. We raised a total of $110 million in this thing.
Gosh.
200 engineers. Product was wonderful. We had it in a number of telecom labs. Like Sprint and MCI and Enron. But then, if you remember those names, you remember 2001.
Right.
The dot bomb happened, so
right.
These companies who loved our product couldn't afford, and so the company had to be wrapped up because no idea when the market was going to come back because the dot bomb was so bad. So it was beautiful product, customers loved it, and shit hit the fan, yeah. So there was just no market. I mean, now it probably would, you know, and in fact, I was calculating the other day, it was a 2.5 terabit switch in 2000 technology. So we were doing quarter micron technology, 600 megahertz links. And if I scale this now, you know, chips are 100 times denser, 10 to 20 times faster links. We'd make a 2.5 petabit machine with today's technology. So it's still fantastic technology.
So did anybody ever pick up that technology?
No. So it's just sitting there and some patents and I guess some documentation tucked away. But no, it's never gone anywhere. It's never been rejuvenated.
I mean, but if it were made today, it would still be a competitive product.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. It would be killer product today.
Hmm.
But you have to spend a lot of money. You know, you spend $50 million on a chip and whatever a chip costs these days and to do it. So it would be a big deal to resurrect it. So somebody would have to say, okay, I'm really convinced of this and I'm going to do it. So there'd be a big upscale thing to sell it. So,
right.
You know, maybe a Cisco or somebody could potentially use it, but trying to penetrate them to get them to be interested in it was this extraordinarily difficult task.
Mm-hmm.
So let me go back. So that closed down, but so let me go back. I forgot about it. 95, I guess it would have been. I was approached by a gentleman called Orlando Gallegos, who was working with God, I wish my memory wouldn't fail me now. Accelerator company, and
what was his last name? Orlando
Gallegos, G-A-L-L-E-G-O-S.
Okay.
Gallegos.
What, a logic accelerator? Or?
Yeah,
Like Xilinx?
Zicad. Sometimes things bubble up slowly.
Yeah.
Zicad. And one of their engineers had their problem. They were building these accelerators out of FPGAs. And when the engineers realized that their limitations were the existing FPGAs, they just weren't right for their product line. And he had this idea of how to make better FPGAs with using non-volatile technology. Mm-hmm. And so since I had a background in gate arrays, and I'm not sure who put Orlando and I together, but he contacted me, and Zicad carved out a small group of us. I came in as a consultant, and just to look at building these gate arrays. And so we started that. We built these non-volatile gate arrays, flash-based gate arrays. Very dense, like twice as dense as Xilinx, because you only needed this tiny non-volatile bit to store the information instead of a four transistor or six transistor cell they're using. And but on the flip side of that, we had process development. So we had it was a flash-based Fowler-Nordheim tunneling programming or erasing, and flash-based EEPROM-style hot electron programming. And so we worked with a couple of companies. One in Japan, Rome, Japan, and another was a Taiwanese, small Taiwanese company, Hualan. But they never quite got their act together with the processing there, so we worked with Rome a lot and built this. But the issue when you're trying to do technology, you're trying to develop that technology, which is complicating your process quite a bit, you're also then, you have to port it to a process which then is starting to get old by the time. So you're always living with an older process,
yeah.
A more complex, lower yielding process, but a much smaller chip.
Right.
But it still worked out. All the economics worked out well. But it was, you realize that, my goodness, if you're going to change processes, you got to have some serious advantages. You can't go in there for a small
right.
little advantage. And so that we developed full big place and route systems and automation and all that type of thing. So that was, we were getting the age of full automation by then, but mm-hmm. the largest at the time was 10,000 gates. And that was a struggle for design tools to do at that point.
So did they actually use that in a product?
Oh yeah, so they marketed that and mm-hmm. were I guess moderately successful. And eventually they spun out a company called Gatefield.
Or
actually
that.
A division called Gatefield.
Right.
And then I got some stock in that company.
It was Jim Fiebiger ran that.
Was he? Did he actually? Maybe he did run that for a while. I can't remember.
Or part of it, I don't know. He had some role in it.
Yeah. Yeah. He was involved a little bit. He did some introductions for me in Japan. But then Zicad, the only customer Zicad had towards the end was Intel. Because
mm-hmm.
Intel, I guess, they probably limited the amount of silicon overhead in their processors for competitive reasons, so they got tough testing. And to guarantee good testing, they need acceleration because you couldn't really do it without it. But they eventually became the only customer that was really interested in these accelerators. So eventually, Zicad just said, there's just no money in developing the next generation accelerators. And they closed their accelerator doors, got reinvented as Gatefield. And so Gatefield was around for a few years. And then eventually Gatefield was purchased by Actel. So Actel had some other complementary products. And they called this their ProASIC line. And it may even still exist to this day. It was around for a long, long time. It may even still exist to this day. I haven't really looked up. But it was always with the two. They were always more specialty markets. Because
right.
Xilinx and Actel were just such fierce competitors. So they looked specialty. They were non-volatile, so you didn't need this extra EEPROM, for better or worse, right?
Mm-hmm.
So nobody could steal your design. So once you locked it, it's locked. And it was also non-volatile, so like military and stuff really loved that type of stuff. It was completely, once it was done, it was completely protected. There's no way to reverse engineer, because it was just this little bit, a few electrons on some gates somewhere.
Some charges.
Some charges, yeah. You try to reverse, the charges would go away, and that's
right.
the end of it. And I got some nice patents on that. In fact, I got probably, out of my 20 patents, probably the only patent that I'd say was totally bulletproof, there was no way around. And that was a way of programming to avoid hot electrons that you had to program under 1.2 volts.
Under what?
1.2 volts.
Oh.
So hot electrons, term hot electrons, at a certain voltage, they accelerate enough to become what's called ballistic, and they will penetrate the oxides. And there's some energy barriers, and that's around 3 volts or something like that, the energy barrier, if I remember right. But of course, there's a distribution. It's like water molecules evaporating. There's a few that always will get through. But once you get down below, I think it's like 1.2 volts, it's basically not an issue. It's mm-hmm. just, if you have any, they're so small, it's not to be an issue. And so because I incorporated this that you could program this, you had to stay below 1.2 volts, there was absolutely no way around that somebody could get around that type of patent, which was interesting because, you know, you look at patents, they're good, but there's always some way of doing it. Some maybe not as good and maybe a pain in the neck, but it's always a way. This was the only one there was no technical way to get around a patent, except, you know, if you're mm-hmm. going to be a DRAM or a SRAM memory or something, totally different technology.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that was fun. So that was a nice thing.
So after that, then you went on and did this Brightlink.
Then I did the Brightlink thing. Yeah, then I did the Brightlink thing.
Not too bad. You have a great technology, and the market disappears under you, huh?
Yeah, I'm kind of destroying my life. So after Brightlink, I took a year off. Said, heck, we'll just take a year off.
Yeah.
And then I started looking around for other interesting things, and I got back with Phil Hughes and started looking at, is there any networking and things. And we had hooked up another engineer who was into networking, and we were looking at, can we do our networking or anything? And we came up with the idea of a TOA, DCP offload engine for specialty things like particularly storage. And we were taking a look at some other things. And we did some, we got like $500,000 funding on the seed funding. And you know, I had some
to look at what? Say it again.
It was Ethernet tow engines, TCP offload engines, where they were trying to speed that up. And a number of people were doing, and I forget what our wrinkle was, but it was different than what other people do. And I think it was because we were tying into the networking, or what the proposal was. So it was tightly coupled to the networking.
Mm-hmm.
But after we got the money, we started doing some serious market research and really found out there wasn't a market to support the cost of developing the chip and such. So we went back to the VCs and said, sorry, you know, we quite honestly don't think it's a good business idea after all. So they appreciated that, but they said, you know, we had still money left, a couple hundred thousand or whatever it was still left, and said, keep the money. I guess it was more trouble for them to take the money back. So we kept the money and started looking around other ideas. So Phil Hughes, my partner, he's a little crazy, innovative guy, and he was looking at things, and he went off, and I did a little time off. I was, looking around for things and not doing, working too hard, really. And he says, you know, we still got this networking technology, and he was proposing using it in big computer systems, supercomputer systems, and came up with these things. So we started going around trying to peddle that, and went around to VCs, and one of them was Carlton Amdahl, you know, Gene Amdahl's son. Mm-hmm. And he looked at it and he says, well, yeah, you can get this now. You can make this really, really dense computer. How are you going to cool it? We think, oh, yeah. So never to be give up on something. We said, well, let's take a look at cooling. So we started looking at cooling, and we came up with some interesting ideas about conductive cooling. So we looked at things and said, you know, we can use cold plates and we can cool things with conductive cooling.
Mm-hmm.
And we were talking to this company called Liebert, subsidiary of Emerson Electric, and they had this pump refrigerant used R134A, but in a pump, not a compressor. You just use it in two-phase boiling mode. And so you pump it in there, evaporates, and you have a very small amount of fluid, and also no water leakage or anything like that to worry about. And so we worked some thing with them, and we got some money from the California, it's called Pure Grant. It's an energy thing where they get money from some of your bill on your PG&E bill goes to these peer grants. And we got a $100,000 grant from that. So we started developing technology, came up with a pretty good way to do it, went back, got another grant for actually implementing it. And we looked at, well, what's the best way what do we need to do? So we first applied this to a one-use service. We thought, okay, well, let's start with a standard pizza box. And we came up with a system to cool these by taking out the heat risers and heat sinks and replace them with essentially blocks of aluminum, which are called heat risers, put a special thermal material, which proprietary thermal material on this, and put it under a cold plate, which we could crank down, and then it was cool the system with a totally cool the server with no air. Mm-hmm. And we built these racks with that, and we Emerson prepaid some orders on that and eventually bought some of these racks, and they were going to distribute that. But they turned out to be kind of a mediocre partner because their infrastructure and it really to sell was to the IT people.
Yeah.
So that was kind of languishing. But then the stimulation package came along with Obama, and they $50 million of that was put aside for high performance computing energy. And so on a kind of let's put a thing in. And we put a $2.6 million grant in to build a supercomputer, blade-based supercomputer to prove our product. What the heck, if you can't? you have to sell it, you got to demonstrate it some way. And we put together a consortium to hold this whole thing. I'm still, it was almost on a lark, and you know, in a sense, because, you know. But
so you use standard processors and what?
Yeah, so we got so we still got Liebert involved. They were going to supply the cooling system, the pump refrigerant system to this blade rack, mm-hmm. and also the Emerson Electric Vision power supply. So it was a 380-volt power supply distributed through a blade-based system. We got Intel to give us 600 of their state-of-the-art processors for a dollar a piece, and they were like $1,700 retail. So it was like over $1 million. I don't know how we ever got Intel to give us $1 million worth of mm-hmm. processors, but because you know Intel's very tight.
Power is a big problem.
Yeah, because that was a big problem. So yes, so that was that, and then we've got Slack as a partner as a demonstration. So we'd build this and we put it into Slack, and so we spent a couple of years, 2.5 years, about building a system, 2.5, almost 3 years by the time we were done, and. Had this thing installed, put this thing in Slack. So it was a rack capable of 100 kilowatts. Nominally, the servers would do about 80 kilowatts, but in reality, they'd draw about 60. So we had this very dense one rack, 60 kilowatt system. And since it was totally liquid cooled through the pump refrigerant, which is just things just attached to their hot water system in their facility, cold water system, I mean, and put the pump refrigerant through it. And to demonstrate that this didn't need any, we didn't need any special facilities. This was just put on the side, just off in a little room off a loading dock, mm-hmm. where it was, you know, we ran some optics to it mm-hmm. to interface to it. So it was just sitting there in this room quietly, humming away for 2 years. And we had a couple little mechanical things we first started, solved those, and then the thing ran for 2 years without a single failure of any sort. No electronics, nothing.
How did you program it? I mean, you put a computer together like that, it needs special operating system and stuff?
Well, no. The Slack has their software. It's all standard. It was Intel boards. So it was 256 processors, 128 boards. And they would just network together through standard networking and, you know,
So they could just use, they had software that would...
They had software, yeah. Yeah, they're multiprocessor software that's all kind of standard stuff for people in the supercomputer businesses. Yeah.
Right.
And so they used that for 2 years. They ran in one of their, in fact, their flagship program right now, what they call, which is this laser thing they have, where they can, and they did all the simulations and look at the results with that. So that was a very successful product.
Wow, and you only built one?
We only built one. Again, it's the issue of trying to sell these things. You know, okay, we got the demo. Everybody loves it, but...
Okay, so this started out when Carlton Amdahl said, you know, well, how are you going to cool it? Did
So we decided to go into cooling. So pick one or the other, cooling.
But you had another technology.
Yeah, so we went back and came up with a cooling system, went back and to him and to others, and they said, okay, you got these two technologies, pick one. Well, can't do the density, so we had to pick the cooling. And really didn't know anything about, you know, cooling per se at the time. So again, I went from ICs to networking to cooling, so why not have another fire hose of learning, you know, and do enough new things. I throw some new patents at it, you know, because it's the wrinkles we were doing were different enough from anything out there. So all conduction cooled, no air blowing, no liquids to connect or unconnect. So it was very, very unique, good product, wow. Worked well.
And is it still in operation?
It's sitting unplugged in our lab right now.
Oh, so they used it for 2 years and then didn't use it anymore.
Yeah.
So you got a whole, but you got a rack of 600 Intel processors.
Well, I probably shouldn't say this publicly, but no, they were still worth $1,000 each in the gray market. So we supported ourselves with
Intel processors. Sell one. Yeah. I need another $1,000.
I guess I don't need the Intel. Thank you, Intel.
Fascinating. Yeah. Fascinating.
But they should have bought it to put in their science system, darn it.
Yeah. Seems like it.
They should have demoed it.
So what years was that operational?
12 through 14.
No, so this is something fairly like recent.
That. Yeah, fairly recent. And so yeah. And so now I'm kind of, I guess, semi-retired. We came up with one last product after that.
And so you have semiconductor design, you have cooling, you have networking, you know. you put all these together and do something, right?
Yeah. That and $5 and I can buy a cup of coffee, you know, the old line, right? So now we got another product with the OCP, Facebook OCP. We make a liquid-cooled version of that with water-cooled. And got a nice little product, and we got a partner company trying to flog that. And we'll see how that turns
Facebook
out. OCP, the Open Compute Platform.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So we took their...
Your cooling technology with that platform.
Yeah, in another wrinkle. It fits right in. We can insert it into their rack. And we just changed their trays a little bit design, and we have this. So we can do a totally...
And then you don't need any air cooling?
None. And it's quiet. You know, that's the nicest thing about it. One of the things when you start working with these liquid cooling things... You find out how much you trained with your ear, you know. Okay, it goes shh, and it goes shh, and it goes shh.
Yeah, right.
Okay, now it's booted, right?
Right.
And then there's no sound. There's no fans. Nothing's running. And look at the lights. Is that the correct light pattern?
So this is conduction cooling, but how do you get rid of the heat?
Okay, so the heat comes through a cold plate,
yeah.
And depending on the fluid, then it goes to a chiller or heat exchanger of some sort.
You said... Not liquid cooling, but I mean there is liquid going through.
There's liquid going through the cold plates,
right?
And then that liquid is cooled through some sort of heat transfer mechanism,
right?
Which in a sense we don't care about, you know. And it's this OCP version is plug compatible. You just plug it into the cooling system as long as in a data center, as long as it's above dew point, it's fine.
I see.
So it's a lot less complicated. You don't have to buy a Liebert pump system with it.
Is it still the same thing with the cold plate bound to the seat sinks?
Yes. Yeah. In fact, we recycled a lot of the slack boards to put them in the demonstration system for
OCP.
Mm-hmm, for the OCP. So now that's a small company called Aquila down in New Mexico has the demo system, and they're going out trying to sell it, and it's all fairly recent. So.
Yeah, I mean, that actually is sort of an interesting area. I mean, I've been fascinated by the fact that the whole world of computer companies has been turned upside down because there are so many companies like Facebook and Google and others that are building their own processor boards, right, that go into their data centers.
Mm-hmm.
And so a huge amount of the computer business is just kind of gone away, or you have to think of Google and Facebook as being the computer companies, right?
In some cases, yeah. And of course, they have a big NIH and, you know, They want to do it their ways. Anyway, I remember a few years ago, some Google engineers came to tour what we're doing, and, you know, one of you goes, oh, we can build that. Oh, get your ass out of here, you know? Yeah, you probably could. You could spend a couple of years reverse engineering it and build it. And thank you, but We don't think we need that here.
Right.
And in face, you know, it's kind of interesting. We started the cooling. It looked like we were perfect because, you know, it was a thing about energy saving, green, and everything like that, and lots of things has got the curve perfect. But in 8 years, it's just amazing. You hardly hear anything about green energy saving or anything anymore, even in Obama, much less the current administration.
Hmm.
So the uptake, you know, the big thing is green, but you save money. But it's a complex sale. It's a conservative business, so it's a complex sale, as it turns out. So you can save money. You don't have to build facilities. Your energy costs drop down.
So in a data center, what fraction goes to the cooling and versus just powering the devices? What's the?
It varies a lot, and it varies how you measure it. But typical data center, probably next to 40% is probably an average of what goes to cooling and blowing air around and things like that.
Wow.
But they cheat. They got a measure of system they call PUE, power usage efficiency. And they take the fans in the servers, they consider that computer usage. So instead of saying this should be on the other side of the equation, this is really power wasted.
Right.
And it can be, we've measured 20 to 40% is, you know, in a hot room they've gone to, oh, we'll warm the data centers and things like that. But we've measured when you you run a server up to near its upper limit of temperature, up to 40% of the power can be going to the fans. It's crazy. If you're really, really cold, it might be 5 or 10%. But so it varies depending on a whole bunch of things.
Now, with this cooling, can you actually clock the processors at a higher rate?
Oh, yeah. We're in turbo mode all the time. With our system was always in turbo mode on the Intel chips.
And is that possible with air cooling? Or
maybe in slightly heroic air cooling.
So it seems like that would be an advantage. I mean, just
There's so many advantages. You can run, you can keep them cooler. You can run turbo mode all the time. It's quiet. The environment's nice. No fans to vibration, which leads to reliability and maintenance, of course. And one of the more subtle things is, if you look at a typical chip nowadays, they ramp from a few watts to 100 watts in microseconds or milliseconds, and they have tremendous thermal shock as this changes, and then this lightweight heat sink goes up and down. So it's basically thermal shock all the time, every time you're running from a light load to high load on a chip. So that's killing these chips. You put this big old heat riser, this aluminum block, that just keeps that chip at a, it doesn't move temperature-wise very much at all.
Wow.
You know, it's a very slow process. It's a thermal cycle rather than a thermal shock. And that's a big deal with semiconductors. That's apparently why we had no failures, but not even we had no failures in disks, we had no failures in other components, anything, nothing. 2 million server hours is what we calculated the system was at.
Wow.
So, interesting. So that brings me...
Here we are.
Here we are.
Yeah. Well, that's a... I came to hear a Gatorade story and I found out a lot more. See, it's... You've been through it all.
Yeah, it's just kind of a serendipity
every
career.
Every kind of technology, from oil wells to chip design to cooling towers to, pretty interesting. Well, thank you very much, Bob. I really appreciate your spending the time with us. And
thank you.
Turned out to be quite an interesting tale you had to tell. So congratulations.
Thanks. Kind of fun visiting the past.
Yeah.